conversation with the Honorable Director, Professor V. Ramgopal Rao. He has served as the PKK chairperson, chair professor for nanotechnology in the Department of Electrical Engineering of IIT Bombay and as the chief investigator of the Center of Excellence in the nanoelectronics project. He is also a co-founder of the company Nanosmith Technologies Private Limited at IIT Bombay, which is developing products in the area of nanotechnology. Professor Rao has over 400 publications in the area of electron devices and nanoelectronics in international journals and conference proceedings, and is an inventor of 35 patents and patent applications with many of his patents licensed to industries for commercialization. Professor Rao is recognized with many awards and honors in this country and abroad. He is a recipient of the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in Engineering Sciences in 2005 and the Infosys Prize in 2013. He also served as the chairman IEEE APED Bombay chapter and as the vice chairman IEEE Asia Pacific Regions chapter's subcommittee for 2 terms. As a director at IIT Delhi, he has already made several welcome changes and the student community looks forward to many more. How this event will proceed is very simple. First, we will invite Professor Ramgopal Rao to give a small lecture, a small talk on his life, and after that we'll open the floor to questions. So may I invite the professor.
If you have any questions, other administrative matters, you are free to ask. I think eventually, I am answerable, so therefore you can ask questions. But since it talked about my life and all that, I should tell you, I am midway, I am not really very old. So you should not make it look like some lifetime achievement or anything like that. I still believe I have a long way to go. It's just, it's just a beginning. And so before coming here, thinking of, how it has always been with me. What is that I did to be here today? And what is that I am doing? And also, in fact, I don't know how many of you have read about my profile on the web and saw what I was doing earlier and all of that. I come from a very small village, in fact that was in Telangana. I speak Telugu, my native tongue is Telugu. But of course it was all in the community, it was a common state. I come from Mahabub Nagar district. I don't know how many of you have heard about it. But the general saying in Mahabub Nagar was, if you want to know why a separate Telangana state is required, you should come to Mahabub Nagar and see the poverty kind of thing. So it was such a poor district. There were all kinds of, hunger, deaths and all of that. So I come from a small town there called Kolhapur. It's not Kolhapur. Kolhapur is in Maharashtra. This is Kolhapur, K-O-L-L-A-P-U-R, which I'm sure nobody would have heard about. And it was, but of course it was also in the news because of me. And if you see today Kolhapur, they have a web page, they do take pride in certain things. So it was a small town. I studied in Telugu medium until 12. I had no exposure to English. I could barely speak a sentence until I graduated with my dual standard. It was entirely in Telugu medium. So after Telugu medium, like many JEE, as you know, was never an option for somebody from an interior part of Telangana. So for us, getting there, at that time there was MSET, that exam in the AP, the combined AP state. So I took the MSET and then I got a rank and I went to Kapti University and then I did my BTEC, the instrumentation. But of course, whatever I was doing, I was good at it. Even in school in Telangana, many students used to fail. It was a small village kind of a place nobody used to come there, the lecturers particularly. We had our entire 2 years of intermediate without a regular maths lecturer. It was that bad because everybody who comes there, would start working on their class. The first thing that they keep trying is to get transferred out of that place because there is nothing there. For their families and for their children, it was never a place to settle down. So therefore, there was never hardly any good teacher or anything. And but in that Kolhapur town, we did very well with whatever limited resources we had. We used to set records in terms of how many marks you can score in the 10th standard, 12th standard and all that. Then I did my B.Tech from Varangal and nothing much to talk about. And for family reasons, I lost my father when I was in second year. And so after that I took up a job. And then I took up some jobs and then I went to IIT Bombay. So that was in a way the turning point in my life. So when I went to IIT Bombay, I joined M.Tech there in microelectronics. And that was really great because IIT Bombay offered lots of opportunities. And that was the first time I could see good teachers, good people. So I came in contact with some of the greatest people. And after M.Tech, But there was never really any major aim in life. It was just that you wanted to study, you wanted to do well in whatever you were doing. And so we just did M.Tech, and there were job offers, but then my professor there said, why don't you join for PhD? So I joined for PhD, and that was in microelectronics. And then after that, M.Tech in microelectronics joined PhD, we were doing PhD, everything was again working fine. But then, there was an opportunity, there was this DAD fellowship, I'm not sure, I think here also many students go on this Indo-German fellowship program. And there was this DAD announcement for some PhD fellowships in Germany, which were entirely paid by the German government. So there was an announcement for DAD fellowship, and then my professor said, why don't you apply? So I applied and then got selected. I went to Germany. The DAD fellowship was you go there for about a year. You do your 1 year of PhD work there, come back to IIT Bombay, submit thesis and graduate. So that was what the DAD fellowship was all about. That was called the sandwich model PhD program. So I went to Germany, I went to Munich. I spent about a year there. And then the professor, they said, why don't you, submit your thesis here? Why do you want to go back? I had spent just about 6 months in Bombay, IIT Bombay, and about a year in Germany. And the professor, they said, why do you want to go back? Why do you want to submit your thesis here? So then I wrote back to IIT Bombay saying that I want to, this is what they are saying. Is it okay? Get away. And IIT Bombay was very kind. The professor said, in India, still a foreign degree is a foreign degree. That was in 1997. So it was in 1997. They said, it's a foreign degree in India still. Though you can get a degree from IIT Bombay, but if you have a German degree, it may be better. So he said, why don't you submit it there? And then IIT Bombay sent me a no objection certificate. I submitted thesis there. So I had a very quick PhD, 6 months in IIT in Bombay. And about a year, almost like within 2 years I could get my PhD. And so after my PhD in Germany, that was doctor engineer, that is, I don't call it a PhD. So I started applying for jobs. And I got a postdoctoral fellowship in University of California, Los Angeles. And I then went to UCLA. And I spent 2 years there, close to 2 years. And it was a good time. I mean, in UCLA, I was there exactly for about 18 months on the roles there. And I wrote something like 36 papers in those 18 months, which is, in fact, some of the highest cited papers of my professors in UCLA were with me as the co-author. And so everything was working very well. And then after the UCLA, things were doing very well. There were a lot of good projects, Intel and other industries. So then I could have taken up a job there. But then IIT Bombay said, why don't you come back and join us? So there was a kind of an invitation to join IIT Bombay as a faculty member, as an assistant professor. And for me, I just jumped at it. Because for me, had it not been IITs, I don't think I would have come back. When I look back, it was the fact that faculty position in IIT, for me coming from the background that I had, an IIT faculty position was everything, you know, like a dream job kind of thing. So I said I will come back, and then I came back and joined IIT Bombay. That time I had an option between IIT Bombay and IIT Delhi. If I wanted, I could have joined IIT Delhi at that time. But then, since I was an alumnus of IIT Bombay, since I knew everybody there, a lot of familiarity with the place, so I went back to IIT Bombay. And so I spent 18 years at IIT Bombay. I mean, after joining there, I joined in 98 August, and when I left, it was very close to 18 years spent. And, you know, again, we came back, and when you come back, and well, I was working on my area of research is all in nanoelectronics. I work in, you know, the integrated circuits which go into mobile phones and laptops and desktops and all of that. Those integrated circuit technology is where I specialize. And much of my work involved working for Intel projects, IBM projects, Texas Instruments project, and various semiconductor, Infineon, and Siemens. So I had many industry kind of projects. And so in all of those kind of projects, we take industry projects, solve the problem, file patents, and earn money. In fact, after coming to Delhi, my salary has become half. I used to earn two times more money as a faculty member at IIT Bombay. And here, you know, as a director, I don't feel comfortable doing industry projects and all that. I don't want to do that. So therefore, things were working very well. So I came back to Bombay and joined in 98. And like every faculty member, you know, you have worked on certain topics in US, you come back, you work on the same topics. There are faculty members who retire doing the same thing. So I also, for almost like 6 years, until 2004, 2005, I was working on similar topics. And whatever I was doing in US, and CMOS, these are all called the complementary metal oxide semiconductor technologies. And so everything was good. And but around 2004, my work started getting recognized. I got in 2005 Shantisvarup Bhatnagar Prize, which is the highest award in India for scientists. And before that, I got the Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, which is again very prestigious kind of a fellowship. So when I started getting recognition, I also started to feel a little bit restless, in the sense that, you know, after all, why have I come back to India? If I have come back to India to work for Intel, IBM and all these companies, I could have done that better by being in US. If I have come back to India, I should be doing something for India. I should be working on some problems which can make an impact in the society. So around 2004-2005 time frame, I started to look at what can I do for solving any of the India's problems kind of thing. So that was one thing which I consciously started working on. And then we started to form teams, and that is when, you know, at IIT Bombay we said, to do any problem, you know, we need multidisciplinary kind of activities. And for example, with the first project we took up was a cardiac diagnostic system. We said, can you make a 100 rupee cardiac diagnosis possible? If somebody has a chest pain, in 100 rupees can you rule out that the chest pain is not because of cardiac problems, but because of something else? So can there be a sort of a quick test, 100 rupees, 10 minutes, to rule out people who may have a cardiac problem, and or to diagnose the cardiac problem? Or rather, can you predict heart attacks? If you have a chest pain, can you say with some test that 6 months from now you are going to have a heart attack? So we started to take up such a project. But to develop those kind of prototypes, just with electrical background, we couldn't really do much. So I had to, you know, we had to form a team. We had the Department of Department of Biomedical Engineering at IIT Bombay. We had people from chemistry, people from material science, people from mechanical engineering. We had at least 5 different departments involved. So we wrote a project, we got funding for it, and then we started working on a real problem where the solution will change, reduce the heart attack related deaths in the country. Because in India, every 4th death happens because of heart attack anyway. So we started working on technologies, and then we did quite a bit of work. And so that was what we started as a company, the NanoSonic Technologies Private Limited, which the student mentioned. It is the first company we incubated in the technology space. And so the company is now 5.5 years old. I think they will now survive and they are launching their products and all that. And after that, we took up our second project, which was an explosive detector. We said, can you replace sniffer dogs? You know, when you go to airports and all of that, you see these dogs used for sniffing explosives. We said, can you develop an electronic nose platform which can replace a sniffer dog? That way, if you can make an electronic nose, a sensor, you can put it everywhere and it will be so easy to deploy it in airports and all of that. So we took up our second project, which was electronic nose platform. We again built prototypes and we transferred the technology to a company in NanoSniff. And after that, I started working on agricultural sensors. And there again, we started another company recently called Soil Sense Technologies Private Limited. So I found that agriculture is one area where a lot of innovation is possible. And if you can solve some of the problems in agriculture, you not only can make help boost the India's GDP, but you also solve problems with the farmers. And so we developed some technologies for agriculture. That's another company. We incubated it at Bombay Soil Sense Technology. So I have two startups, technology startups, hardcore technology startups, where there are many people working. Many of my PhD students are running these companies now. Things were good. In terms of research, making those complex technologies always resulted in a lot of good publications, many patents. So we were able to write lots of papers, good papers, file many patents. So I think everything worked very well. At the end of the day, we were also able to develop prototypes and then market them, start companies, work with industry. So it has been a very enriching kind of an experience so far. And when I look back, I think things worked very well. Initially, I just started with no aim in life. For somebody from those kind of backgrounds, to me, I thought getting a government job, from the family backgrounds I came from, getting a government job, marry two children, that was all what was required. But then once I started getting exposed to more and more things, but I should say IIT Bombay, the IIT system changed my life. I think with IIT Bombay, IIT Delhi, they are all the same. And I see so many great things happening at IIT Delhi. So therefore, IIT system changed my life. I did not have an opportunity to come to IITs for my bachelor's because in Telugu medium it was never an option for us. But coming to without having gone to an IIT, I don't think I would have achieved anything. So to me, that was a turning point in life, going to an IIT for my master's and then making use of whatever opportunities IIT provided. Once I went to IIT, I did not want to leave IIT. I stayed with it for forever. But I don't think I will ever quit my job in an IIT and here and there. So that was a great thing. IIT system, the best reason why one would come to IITs to me was the people. The kind of people at least I could meet and interact with, I could not have got them anywhere in the country. You go to any college, any NIT, you will not still see some of the people whom you see in the IIT system. And interacting with them, rubbing shoulders with them, discussing with them, that gave me the confidence. And I met some of the best faculty members, best colleagues, students, the staff. I think it just provided that right atmosphere. And that was the turning point. So that's what my life so far has been simple. So unless something big happens here, I want it to be simple. So it's all looking good. I hope those companies which we started, the PhD students who are running them, and my aim now is to do some real technologies which people will use. And we want every airport to have the explosive detector that we are building. And we want our soil sensors to be used by every farmer in the country. And when that happens, I think, life would be enriching, life will be satisfying. And these positions, these are all, I came here and many people, in fact, I've seen my profile. I never wanted an administrative position. I told myself that until I am 50 years of old, I will not occupy any administrative position. So I consciously kept myself away from any administrative position. I focused all my research. I have graduated 40 PhD students. There are still 10 PhD students at IIT Bombay. At my age, 50 PhD students in India is a big number. So I worked so hard and I had so many students wanting to work with me. I got the best students, and I got, and we have built at IIT Bombay, we built almost 300 crore worth facilities, large projects. We used to interact with many people. So a lot of things we did which made a big difference to the institute, which my students are all doing very well. So I never thought administrative position was anything important. So, but once we started companies, once there was a proper ecosystem built in order to do that, for example, the cardiac diagnostic system took almost like 10 years. From conceptualizing it to building a prototype took us 10 years. The explosive detector took us about 4 years. And the agricultural sensor took us about 2 years. So we realized that initially when you are doing something like that, it takes a lot of time because you don't see many people in the country, building products, the technology intensive kind of products. So that takes time. But then, but as we started learning, the ecosystem also got built, and things started looking good. And we were writing lots of papers, and we were only competing with ourselves in terms of the quality of papers, the quantity of papers, and I was then realizing that I'm getting into a comfort zone. So at some point of time, I felt that now I need to do something more. And so there was that restlessness and what next kind of thing. So when I was 50 years old, and so when somebody said, I would like to nominate you for this position, I said, fine, let me see what happens kind of thing. Since I never had any administrative experience in the real sense of the word, let me try it. So now, suddenly from no administrative experience to director IIT Delhi, imagine, it's in the middle of the political capital of the country. It's fun. But then I see that, at the end of the day, it's all about managing people. It's all about working with people. I think, that is all what matters. And when I was in the committee, and the biggest concern of the committee members, committee which interviewed me was, what will happen to the research activities that you started at IIT Bombay? They were not worried about my administrative experience. They were all worried, all of them knew me. They all were worried, what will happen to what you started doing at IIT Bombay? Who will, take forward those activities? What will happen to your, the facilities that you built? They were more worried about, my research output rather than, anything else. And that was because, that was what I was doing 100% of my time. And now, I still have students there. I have started taking students here. I am still doing research. I'll continue to do research. But I think administration is all about being a good human being and being working with people, understand the problem. It is not a rocket science. So, in the last 1 year, we did more things than any 1 year in the IIT Delhi's history. We started so many new departments. We have a department of design coming up. We have a school of interdisciplinary research approved. We took so many new initiatives. Now I think another couple of years down the line, we should be there. And in fact, this year compared to last year, in the last 1 year, the QS ranking of IIT Delhi went up by at least 8 points. Otherwise, the rankings were all sliding. So now the ranking is getting better. And 5 years from now, I want to see IIT Delhi in the top 50 in the world, and we know how to do that. It's just a matter of, just finding those resources and doing things the right way. So I think, at the end of the day, I realized that working with people, motivating your team, because even as a PhD supervisor, as a professor, that's what you do. In our areas, you don't go to the lab and conduct any experiments. You generate ideas, then you motivate your students, and they do all the work. So it's all about working with people, and that's what I believe one needs to be able to do. And that's the life history. I mean, so far, that is how it has been, and it has been very interesting. In fact, I see now the fundamental problems that are affecting the IIT system. At least I have been very vocal in many meetings. I do raise the issues with the IIT system, because I think I have nothing to lose. What is it? If I don't stay here, I will go back to IIT Bombay and become a professor. And what is coming? So I have a nice fallback option. So therefore, I have nothing to fear. So I actually, when I was in Rashtrapati Bhavan in a big meeting, I said there is no business model to run the IITs in the country. We are starting institutions. We are good at starting institutions. but we are not good at running this institution. And I actually, you know, made many press statements saying that a lot of things need to change in the IT system. And I do think that, you know, we are, government is not doing enough for IITs. I mean, I'm happy with many initiatives of the government of India, but we have started too many institutions and there is not enough money. And without putting in the resources together, starting so many institutions, now it's affecting all of us. That's what is the current situation with the IIT system. We should have been a little bit careful. A country with our economy cannot afford 23 IITs, I can tell you that. It costs about 1300 to 1400 crores to set up one IIT. And with the kind of money that government of India is spending on higher education, I am worried that we are not doing a good job. In fact, just yesterday, in one of the events in Delhi, I was worried today morning whether Hindustan headlines will be that, but I actually said that the money, you can check it on the web, the money China spends on two universities, Peking University, Tsinghua University, is more than the entire budget of MHRD for higher education. The entire MHRD higher education is equivalent to the two universities that China spends money on. And that is something like 30,000 crores. China spends 30,000 crores on two universities, Peking and Tsinghua universities. And the entire MHRD budget for 120 universities and IITs is basically that kind of money. So now with that kind of money, what do we do? And so hardly any money for anything. If you find that the hospitals are bad, there is no money is there to construct a hospital. And we have been going and begging them, you know, saying that why don't we we need to construct a new girls hospital, new boys hospital, and that's the situation. So that is what currently in the situation. So that this needs to change. This cannot continue, and we just need more money for the higher education in the country. That is what my very strong feeling is, and I am saying it wherever I get an opportunity to do. That's it. And if you, I think maybe we can make it more interactive rather than giving me the lecture. So, yeah.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, a question was in your mind. Sir, like you always talk about an interdisciplinary research among various branches of engineering. Sir, had it been in your mind that instead of very engineering, if we include in multiple disciplines from various, like, an engineer working with, let's just say, a doctor or maybe a philosopher. An engineer working with a philosopher to design better computers. So, what is your take on that?
It's a very good point. I very strongly believe in that because, you know, what has happened in this country is we have fragmented our education so much. In fact, mechanical engineering, civil engineering, electrical engineering, there is nothing like that. If you go to look at nature doesn't have any discipline. Nature, you know, if you put a problem to us, your problem is, let us say, to develop you want to address the soil, you want to develop a system for monitoring soil nutrient concentrations for agriculture. Let's say that is the problem. Now, whether does that problem fall under civil, does that problem fall under mechanical, does it fall under electrical, it doesn't actually fall under any discipline. It is a problem. When you want to solve that problem, multiple disciplines need to come together. With one single discipline, you will not be able to solve the problem at the end. Soil nutrient monitoring for agricultural application, as an example, you will not be able to solve that problem with one single, you know, kind of a discipline. So that is what engineering has to be. Engineering is all about solving problems. Engineering is all about using minimum resources to optimize your resources to solve a problem. That's all what engineering is all about. Engineering is not about, you know, the way we have fragmented it, the way we are actually doing engineering. And unfortunately, you know, the country has also become like, if you want to start an engineering institution, you start IITs. You want to start science, you want to start ICERs. You want to do management, you start IIMs. We have fragmented these institutions so much now that we have forgotten, you know, what is the problem that we are trying to solve. We are doing electrical engineering, but we are actually not solving any problems with that electrical engineering. We are, you know, go to library, find some papers, you know, write a paper, that's what it has all come down. I think that is where that fragmented approach is definitely not working for us. And we have to start looking at problems as problems, not as disciplines. And in fact, couple of weeks ago, we went to AIMS, and I met with the AIMS director. And I told him, you know, why don't we now, we are just next door, AIMS is opposite IIT Delhi, why don't we start a program? I mean, why don't we now start to collaborate more with each other? So we actually said that, you know, can we take 100 PhD students jointly between AIIMS and IIT Delhi? So we will advertise for these positions where there will be a student from IIT Delhi, a student from AIIMS, you know, who will work together on a prof. So that is what we will launch very soon. You will hear about it, but we will have a program. Currently finalizing all the terms and conditions for that. But we will have a program between AIIMS and IIT Delhi, you know, to solve the problem. Because once you put a problem first, then it doesn't matter whether you are a medical doctor or engineer. You know, problem comes at the beginning of everything. I mean, that cardiac diagnostic problem. Today, diagnosis is such a big thing. You know, if you want to develop any such diagnostic tool, you have to have engineers working with the medical doctors. You cannot do any other way. And for the, we also started this program called School of Interdisciplinary Research, which is approved, and we will start admitting students now. There again, we said that now we will make two faculty members from two different departments come together and write a proposal. And they will write a proposal saying that this is the problem that we want to address, and for this we want a student with this background. And we will collect such problems from all across the institute. We will publicize them on a web page, and students will apply against the problem. Students will not apply just to IIT Delhi. They will say that I am interested in this problem. When they apply to that problem, then you know, you will have two supervisors from different disciplines, and they come together along with the student to solve a problem. So I think our education needs to put the problems first. What we started is what we are doing today are completely different things. And if you are good at, you know, at something, you can actually apply that knowledge, and you need to build teams, you need to look at problems, and then you know what discipline background you have, what disciplinary background you have will actually hardly matter. But you need to be good at something, and that is what is important. If you know, one of the things I see people doing is, you have not acquired any skills, you don't have anything, but you still suddenly want to, you know, build a multidisciplinary team and all that, and nobody will work with you. You have to establish yourself, you have to be a good mechanical engineer. Then a civil engineer would want to work with you and look at a problem, you know, that you together can solve. That is what we need to do in IITs, and I believe, you know, actually we have begun that process at IIT Delhi to the School of Interdisciplinary Research with the AIIMS collaborations. Even those 1, 2, 3, 4 discover and learn projects we launched for undergraduate students. You know, again, students working in a team is what is important. Individually, we are nothing. You know, individually, you cannot solve anything. You can maybe go to a computer and write some code here, some code there. But you know, if you want to solve a real engineering problem, you have to work in a team with the people from different disciplines and backgrounds. And therefore, the team building skills are very important. With that, you know, when I first came here, everybody used to take me to the robotics lab, and I saw so many robots who go up and come down. I don't know why they are going up and why they are coming down. Okay. So we said, you know, but why are they doing that? So that, what is the big picture? Why are they building a robot which actually climbs a pole? And nobody had any, you know, then if you ask that question, everybody starts thinking, saying that, okay, but we can apply it here, we can apply it there, we can apply it, you know, but then it doesn't work that way. In engineering, you have to think of a complete problem first, do a problem definition, and then, you know, you start building that particular system. It is not that very often you have a solution and you are looking for a problem. So in many of our research, you know, you already have a solution, and then, you know, what is the problem now, I can apply the solution. And that never unfortunately works. And I think we have somewhere, the reason why we are importing everything, the reason why we are, you know, not developing any products is because all of our engineering has become discipline-oriented, not problem-oriented. And the day you change that, you know, once you put a problem first and then build a team to work on it, we can develop lots of interesting things. Just that change in the approach, change in methodology that is required. At IIT, you know, in my previous life as professor, we did a lot of things. We could know that all of this can be done. And we could change much of this, and you know, it is possible. You know, Indians inherently are very intelligent, and people, and if you are looking for a problem, you don't have to look at anywhere else. India has all the problems of the world. So the entire world's problems are in one country. society in India. So therefore you don't have to go to library to find a problem. You just look around you, you find tons of problems. And every one of those problems, I can tell you, you can write enough number of research papers, you can file enough number of patents, you can spend your entire lifetime solving those problems. Because the problems have become so complex and you don't have to really look at US when you want to look for problems. That's what in my many interviews I said, many US students now, they are actually coming to India to find problems. And our students are going to US to find it. That is exactly what I like. You know? I also gave that example in some of my interviews that I recently had a call from some Ivy League schools from US, and they wanted to send students from MIT, Stanford and all those big schools to India, and they were looking for a village where there is no electricity. They wanted 30 of those students to go to a village without where there is no electricity, wanted them to stay there for a month, and then see how people live without electricity, and then go back and see what kind of technologies that they require. And that is what then we have to look on a map to find out which village doesn't have electricity. We found a village in Madhya Pradesh. They all went there, spent time, and came back with lots of interesting problems. And that is what is, this is where the problems are. And whereas you want a problem, you go to TJ Watson lab and look for a problem there. And that is what it has all come down to. But that is what needs to change now. So we have to start looking at engineering as problem-oriented. Otherwise, once you do that, I can tell you everything else will be fine. That is the kind of a culture that is, I am very keen to build. Go to all these schools and these disciplinary projects, working in a team, putting problem first, everything else will be interesting also. And the starting companies, making money, all that you should do. I don't see any reason why many of you in this room should not be billionaires and yet do great technology development. It's all possible. There was a time when bringing Lakshmi and Saraswati was a problem. If you had a professor making money, everybody had a problem. How can he or she be a professor and make money? Now times have changed. In US culture, if you are smart, you make money. You never say that somebody is smart and not making money. So that smartness is always associated with making money. There is nothing wrong with that. In India also we can do that. If you find a problem, develop a solution, start a company and sell those technologies, what is wrong if you make money? I don't think that a professor should be somebody with kurta pajama, with that bag and all of that. You can be a billionaire professor. There's nothing wrong with that. So I don't believe in those sort of things. So long as you are making money through all correct means, there's nothing wrong in making money.
Sir, what are the key points you think that where IITs are lagging to become the global leader?
IITs are lagging in the global leader. The biggest problem is we are not connected with the society. I think the problem is the students come, right? You are taught analog electronics, right? And you are taught logic design, you are taught all of that, but you don't know why are you learning it. So you are taught 10 different subjects, and then it's your job to put all of that together and to see what I can do. It never works that way. So we have lost that big picture. We are not giving our students that big picture. So in fact, I was telling recently we will have a curriculum review very soon at IIT Delhi. I'm not happy. There was a curriculum review done at IIT Delhi. The first batch has graduated. After the curriculum review, there are more failures. More students are failing after we have revised our curriculum. Something is wrong. In fact, I was also telling somebody that in a course when I see 50% of students are failing, don't blame the students, blame the teacher. It is the teacher who is failing the student and not able to motivate the students and failing those brightest students on the planet. It just doesn't make any sense to me. So that I think the problem lies with the student than with the teacher than with the problem with the student. So there is something wrong with our curriculum. In our curriculum, you take a typical B.Tech student, done math, physics, chemistry for 4 years, you come here and again you teach math, physics, chemistry. I can imagine, I don't know why we do that. But then you say that I don't want to teach it. How can an IIT student not do this math course, and how can somebody graduate kind of a field? So we are doing that. Now we will have a midterm curriculum review where we want to bring in more hands-on kind of things and the courses which are based on a smartphone. You first look at smartphone and see what are the technologies that need to go inside the smartphone you know, to make it better. I think if you do a more top-down kind of a thing, you know, students will find it interesting. Rather than teach them 10 different subjects and ask them to figure out where they can apply them, you know, you first give them some problems and then teach them the contents required so that they can apply them and solve those problems. And that is the kind of an approach that we want to bring in into the curriculum. So that is what I believe in, and that is the reason why I believe we are not really doing very well. Otherwise, great faculty, great students, the facilities are also getting better. But then we never look at anything as this fragmented approach, not able to work together on a problem-oriented kind of skills. I think and we are not working on marginal problems too. How do 99% of faculty find their problem? For PhD students, when a student joins, the first thing we do is go to the library. So you go to library and then you read enough number of journals. There is a literature review which you do for almost like a year. In that you would have read some 100 papers, and then you come and give some seminars and find that, you know, this is done, but this is not done. So therefore you do that and then you write a paper. So you have the next paper, and the next student comes in, reads all those papers. Oh, now this is also done, therefore this is missing. You also do that and you write a paper. Therefore, much of our research starts with the library and ends with the library. After that, nobody ever gets to know that. And that is, you know, in terms of research output, we are doing very well. India now is, ranked fifth or sixth position in terms of our research output, the number of papers written per faculty member. In fact, according to some surveys of Department of Science and Technology, per dollar spent, Indians can write more papers than anybody in the world, compared to even China. And this is actual, real data. So we can do all of that very well. Because Indians are very good at it. When you tell them to do something, they will figure out a way to actually do that. Because we have all been brought up in such a resource-constrained environment that if you are given some resources, we are the people who make best use of it. Because it is in our genes. We never had enough of anything. So therefore, the moment somebody gives us something, we know how to make best use of it. When you go to China, they are wasting a lot of money now in building many things, but in overdoing things. But in India, still we are in that resource constraint thing, whether it is IITs or universities, you know, everywhere. There is a huge constraint on resources. Obviously, we want to make use of it to the best possible way, and therefore we are doing very well in terms of research. But then, you know, because of the way we have structured our entire education system, you know, we are not being innovative. For example, one of the things we are trying to do now at Delhi, you know, the students of the engineers should go to AIMS and work with a doctor during surgery. Now, when a doctor is performing surgery, just stay there. As an engineer, you just look at how surgery is done. That is what it is called, immersion program. There is an IIT Delhi program with AIMS called Bio Design Program, where the IIT students go and spend time in the operation theater observing a doctor how surgeries are done. And as an engineer, when you look at it, now you start asking the question, you know, why is this guy doing this? You know, I could have made that a little bit more automated. I could have done a little bit better in terms of the tools. You know, as a mechanical engineer, you start looking at it as a, whatever discipline you might have come back, you have had, you would look at that problem in a different way. You will come back with problems. And then you can actually develop solutions for that. So these immersion programs are very important, and we need to now design more and more immersion programs. One is what we are starting with AIMS. I also, which is already running, the Stanford Biodesign program. Now Stanford is no longer there, but it, now that activity is further growing. Another thing I want is, you know, students of IIT Delhi to go and stay with the villages. You go to a village, you see, you know, how agriculture is done. How many of us have seen how farming is done today? And when you look at it, you know, there are hardly any technology that they are using. Now, who tells the farmer how much of water to put for that particular crop? Because water, the farmer thinks that water is infinite, and if electricity is there, water is there. So they don't think that, you know, water is a finite resource. And India has, you know, so much of a water problem. We only have 4% of the world's water resources, and we have 18% of the world's population. So we have to conserve water. But 80% of water in states goes for agriculture. In Maharashtra, the human consumption is only 20%. 80% of water goes for agriculture. If we don't save water in agriculture, we are going to, the states are going to fight with each other, and nations are going to fight with each other for water. And that is such a finite resource. And there you need technologies. When a student of IIT Delhi goes and stays in a village, you will very soon hear a kind of an internship program where we will pay you money, we'll pay you 15,000-20,000 rupees to go in a village. We will facilitate the accommodation and all of that. You stay with the villages and see what are their problems. And once you find it, 50% of India lives in villages, and you can come back and develop technologies, start companies, and start making things, start improve the quality of life in the villages. And that is what is required. And going and building a toilet in a village is easy. Somebody gives you money, you will build it. How would you maintain it? Now those require a lot of technologies again, and that is where the technology comes in, and that is where our students, IITs, need to make an impact. And these are the immersion programs that we need to encourage. I mean, students need to go and live in real problem environment and see how things are done, and come back with real problems which they can start to look at as their research and for whatever career that they want to pursue it. And that exposure is not what we are giving. No, we confine you to a room and teach maths, physics, chemistry, or whatever subjects they are, and we expect you to figure out what to do with that, and you apply for a job and find a job, and this is not the way we can ever make any difference. So at least I am very keen to have more and more immersion programs. You go to an industry and spend time in that industry, or you go to a hospital and spend time in the hospital, you go to a village and work with a farmer, live with a farmer and see how farming is done. So these are the kinds of things which I am very keen to do it.
As you mentioned, that one point in which we are lacking is the country. Another point which I can understand is we are lacking in the technical startups of the PhD. So here I have some ideas that I personally feel what is happening is that when a student just pass out in the 12th, he has the pressure from the family that if you get the IIT then it will be great. Okay, after that he somehow gets some rank, and he wants to, even in the JE we are not testing the engineering, we are testing science. One of the points which I feel is in JE we are testing the science, we are not actually testing the engineering. And even the IITs doesn't give the opportunities to the actual student who can do something. Even in the past I have heard a story that there was a girl from the Mumbai. She was 3 times international computer Olympiad, but she was not even have the degree of the 10th. She tries to get to the IIT, but she was not able to get IIT. Then she applied to the MIT, she got there and PhD from the MIT. So one point in which I feel personally that the IIT is lagging is this point. And another point is that when somehow a student fights with the JE and all and gets some rank, and he has interest in X branch, but due to the rank he got some Y branch. Still we have this compact system that he only take 90 students in a particular branch.
So the problems I know, the solutions are more difficult. In fact, you want to test engineering in, let's say, JE. How do you do that? 1.1 million people writing that exam for those 10,000 seats. How would you, design those questions? How would you, yeah. And you are finished now? I think maybe where to finish? Have you done with it? Okay, maybe you can finish it.
So the point which I feel say is that we can identify some good exams, like Olympiads or something, and we can have some sets for them. I am not saying we can...
And now we discussed it, I will tell you what. That's a good suggestion. What is done? Anything more here?
And the second thing is the technical startup for the PhD.
What is that?
Technical startup for the PhD. Okay. So in that point, I want to say that for a PhD student, I myself is a PhD student, if I will, what I feel for the startup is we need to do the two things. One is the research, and another one is the development. If I personally focus on the primary on the development, then it will take a very long time for me to complete my PhD. So as we have started 1, 2, 3 programs, can we do something like if PhD student will be associated with all students, research work will be done by the PhD student, and he can allocate the development work to all students. so that at the end of the PhD he will have the complete R&D report.
Possible. I mean, recently we were discussing with the Dean R&D, so we are trying to do that 1-2-3-4 program, expand it to PhD students and all that, which is one thing which we would definitely like to do. I think that program was basically to teach you, you know, ability to work in a team, nothing beyond that. It is all about, you know, can you work in a team with each other? And that is what you are going to do all your life after your graduation. It is very rare for you to get a project on your own. It will never happen. You are part of a team, and then how do you work in that team? And that is the skill that we want to build. Another reason why we started that program is, you know, many of these projects, like I gave you an example of robotics, they start at one point and end at one point. And the next student, next batch comes, again start at the same point, end at the same point, maybe a little bit incremental. But in these programs like 1, 2, 3, 4, we want them to be relay projects. When a student graduates, another student will come in from a fresh batch and the project continues. Therefore, over a period of time, all of that should result in something which can be substantial and on which one can build a, you know, technology startup and all that. That is, these are the two things which we were trying to solve. One is a team building effort, a skill to work in a team, and secondly a relay kind of a model. So that is how, so we can always look at having more, you know, students from other disciplines or other programs part of that. That is our, you know, no one will be against that. Once a student form a team, you know, institute will support it. I think all of you take it as a message. So if you have 4 or 5 students come together and make it a relay project, and once you apply for funding with a faculty mentor, institute will support it. We just want you to, you know, work on real problems. And the problems need to have some society connect somewhere. So that is all what is required. So the technology startups, you know, it is something which we need to do more and more, having done 2 technology startups myself. Now, right now that ecosystem in the country for technology startups is still not there. To start an IT company is very easy. Today, you know, because of all the good IT companies around, if you are starting an IT company, that ecosystem is there. Now you can, so that's the reason why I see students developing a Adobe app or, you know, this app, that app, and, you know, doing things. So that is easy to do right now. But a technology company, the facilities are important. You need to have access to those facilities. And after that, you need a, you know, VC funding or angel investor to invest in your technology, because technology companies take much longer to launch a product, and for that long you need to survive on private investment, and that also takes time. In India, the pre-revenue technology companies, there is hardly any funding available right now, and things are slightly getting better now. There are more and more VC firms and angel investors who are putting money, but it's a matter of time. I think the more we start doing it, you know, the ecosystem also will come in place. So your question about the JEE pattern, you know, why can't we admit students who have passed Olympiads? This was discussed. We do want to create those avenues, but you know the biggest worry we have changing JEE is we are changing JEE too often, too much. You know, there is again that concern that, you know, it's working now at least decently. Why do you want to tinker with something which is working kind of thing? And secondly, you know, any other avenue you build for entrance to IITs, we are worried that it may be misused. If you say Olympiads kind of a thing, I can tell you suddenly if you say Olympiads is one avenue to get into IITs, the number of people taking Olympiads will go up by 100 times or 10,000 times, because no more and more people will take Olympiads, and those guys will not know how to evaluate so many people taking Olympiads kind of thing. So it has to be, you know, since the competition is so high, at least for the GE exam, any process that you put in place, you know, we are worried about, you know, some misuse around that. So that is a worry which is making people to discuss more and more. Nobody has found a solution, because at least JEE, nobody right now, nobody can complain that, you know, anything has gone wrong kind of thing. I mean, everything, there can be some problems here and there because of the numbers, but otherwise it's a very transparent system. But any other system which is as transparent, we don't know. We are worried about, you know, experimenting too much with an exam, which is the lifeline for so many students. The students spend so much of time, and we don't want to be experimenting with a system, and if something goes wrong, you know, that is a worry that anybody managing the JEE exam has right now. But that is, you know, at some point we need to do that. And, If you had promoted,
so first was a continuation of this question. Sir, rather than doing it on a criterion basis, like the last thing he said, inviting people who have actually done extremely well in Olympiads, rather than inviting them on a criterion basis and inviting them on an invitational basis. And not just for students, but also for professors. Like, sir, if we want to have a program as a guest lecture, if we really want to invite a Nobel laureate, going a bit too far, but yeah, a Nobel laureate to IIT Delhi teaching maybe second year students about some...
We are inviting, we are not coming. We had four Nobel laureates at IIT Delhi. We made an offer to all of them. You come anytime you want and we will give you whatever you need. But you know, because once you get that Nobel Prize, the demands on their time are so high. And for them to come and teach a second year student,
Another question.
But in fact, yeah, I should tell you, we will have soon a Nobel laureate on our faculty. You know, it's in the very final stage.
Second thing was to a fresher. If we are like, this is like, I won't be very honest, brutally honest. A bit too much exposure about research and everything, and sometimes we are like. We are so raw in our minds, we do not understand where to apply things. We have raw ideas, but we don't have the way to how to apply them, to how to apply our own aptitude, how to develop it, and how to actually bring it to life. So as a fresher, so how do I tackle that, and how much challenging is it going to be for me?
I think the best way is for you to be associated with a faculty member very early on. Because all faculty members, the good people, are doing research. Once you are part of that team of a faculty member, you will, you know, figure it out. You are all bright guys. I don't think there is anything that you cannot figure out. So I think you need to be associated with a faculty member. That's the beginning of a research career. You will find interest, you will find problems, you will provide solutions, and everything will work out, you know, fine for you. I think that is something that you should do. Yeah.
Well, my question is, when we look from the institute point of view, we have a lot of problems. But how can me or how can anybody in this room be a researcher from its own? What we have to do on our own? Like when we say that we talk about Newman, Einstein, or Bohr, or anybody like Turing, then they have made themselves. Although the natural talent was there, but some of them have worked so hard and made themselves a researcher. So don't you think we have to work on ourselves? And is this, being an institution, are we focusing on that? Like, I believe that in an IIT, either you kill the enthusiasm of research or definitely not nurturing them. I have felt myself also. So what I should do to, you know, keep myself motivating? Like you said, you have completed in 1.5 years, PhD approximately, and then your postdoc duration, so productive. So being an individual, institute problems are there, they may not be in my control always. But I can do something from my own point of view. First I should start from myself, no? I should not complain all the time.
There are no ready-made models, but I think finding a good supervisor is the first step. Once you become part of a team, a supervisor's or a faculty member's team, then you get exposed to research. And you need a good supervisor. At this stage, you know, for you to develop something on your own, it will be difficult. But I think the faculty members, you need a faculty mentor. Without that faculty mentor, it will be difficult. Now, once you have a faculty mentor, you can actually become better than the faculty member. That is possible. As researchers and as a professor, I want to see my students better than me. Because if my students are inferior to me, then it's a decaying function. After some time, there will be nothing left. So we have, as professors, our goal is to produce students who are better than us and who challenge us. So that has to happen. Therefore, once you have a faculty mentor, then you get to know how research is done, what are the research problems, then you can innovate and do better than that particular faculty member or better than the entire group. I think you have to start somewhere. You cannot just go to library and find a problem. You need to have a good mentor, faculty mentor. I think if at all we need to strengthen it, we need to strengthen the faculty student mentorship program. So I think we will think about it. I think since you raised that problem, we will have to do that more in a more structured manner. Yes,
sir. Yeah. I would like to ask, in all of the multiple projects you've taken for work throughout your life, which one was your favorite, which you had the most fun working with, and which you're most proud of? And another part, which was the one which you had the most high hopes for, but didn't really work out that well, which it had gone much better than expected? And throughout your experience, how have you differentiated that this project is a good one, this project is a bad one, it's just a fantasy, it won't actually work out in real life? So how do you differentiate between a project which actually has a lot of potential and one which does look very hyped but might not be realistic?
It's a good problem, a good question. The way it all evolved was interactions with the stakeholders. You know, when we were looking for these problems, we did not sit in a room and imagine them. We went to hospitals and started interacting with doctors and started asking them what are the problems, you know. And then when we even worked on the explosive detector project, you know, we started interacting with many security agencies and find out, you know, how is security done in Jammu Kashmir, what are the challenges they face on a day-to-day basis. That interaction with the stakeholders is very important. And once you through those interactions, if you define a problem, you know, then all problems become interesting. How many of them can you solve is a different question. That depends on the team, that depends on resources, depends on infrastructure and lot of it. But at least many problems I wanted to work on initially were the problems which will save lives. I wanted, you know, somebody's life to be saved because of a technology we developed. If there is a bomb blast, you know, just imagine if we could detect, if your mobile phone becomes your explosive detector. Now, you know, when you are traveling in a bus, there are 50 people, and if these mobile phones start to detect, you know, presence of explosives, if somebody has put a bag that has explosive, if your mobile phone can track that explosive, and you will immediately know that something is suspicious here, and then start checking the bags, and you know, things can actually improve. So I think in all of those cases, the problems were mainly, you know, which can make a big impact. You can develop a soil moisture sensor at a cost of 500 rupees for an Indian farmer. And if 10% of farmers use your soil moisture sensors to reduce water wastage, you can actually build a $1 billion company out of it. The revenues of the company will be $1 billion. All that you need is a soil moisture sensor a farmer in a village should be able to use, afford. Therefore, the business model innovation also is very important. Why would a farmer buy a soil moisture sensor? You need to innovate in terms of business model, in terms of technology, in terms of cost point. If you can solve those problems, now you can build a $1 billion company out of India today. And that is a problem. And in the process, you can also save water. And you can improve the, you know, quality of life. You can improve the income of the farmer, like what the Prime Minister Modi said, by 2022, double the farmer's income. It is all possible by conserving the water. But that requires high technologies which are made affordable. And making high technology affordable, no problem can be more complex than that. If you're developing the technology for US farmers, no, $25 price point is not a big deal, because those guys can afford it. But in India, $25, no farmer will actually come forward. For them, it has to be $5. Now, how do you make that $25 product a $5 equivalent? And that will require a lot of innovation, a lot of problem solving skills. And therefore, the problems are pretty challenging. These are not problems which are, you know, cheap kind of things. You can actually write papers in top journals if you are able to work on those. Making high technology affordable, you know, is a challenge for India. And many of these problems require high technology. For example, recently we were discussing with a funding agency, you know, a kind of a dome. Now, in a village, there is hardly any healthcare infrastructure. And I was told that every year, 2 crore Indians go below the poverty line because of healthcare related expenditure. And what is this healthcare expenditure? Somebody falls sick in the family, the entire family comes to a big city like Delhi, Bombay, and stays on the footpaths. Now they lose their livelihood, and in the process they go below the poverty line. And this is a big challenge right now, and so many people, you know, today go below the poverty line because of the healthcare infrastructure. What is that you need to do to solve the problem? Doctors don't want to go to a village and treat these people. So you need the technology, a kind of a biodome, where people walk in, you monitor all their vital parameters, the ECG to blood pressure to whatever parameters that you can monitor, connect them to a bigger hospital and then screen people. Because many of these diseases, you will find symptoms very early. And if you are able to regularly screen people in villages through those technologies which are connected to big hospitals and big cities, and then you can only call those people, you can do preventive kind of medication and you can solve many of those problems. That will require many, minimally invasive technologies which can be integrated into a biodome and place them in the villages and keep screening patients, and that are the kind of problems that we need to work on. And if you can do that, again, it will revolutionize the way the healthcare is done in this. But that, to do that, again, you require big teams, you need multidisciplinary kind of projects, but government is willing to fund it. But somebody has to implement those kind of problems. So these are the kinds of problems that we need to work on. So these are all important problems. At the end of the day, saving lives. I think nothing can be more important and interesting than a problem which saves lives. Whether it is avoiding the bomb blast or whether it is helping a patient get treated.
IITs to collaborate with private firms.
I think the right now, that is one thing which we also want to increase. But right now, about 10-15% of our sponsored budget comes from private industry. IIT Delhi this year did about 250 crore worth projects. The total sponsored project money IIT Delhi received was about 250 crores. Out of which about 30-35 crores is what comes from the industries, which is a very small fraction. So we need to increase that. There are many schemes of Government of India where government is saying that if industry puts in 10 rupees, we will put in 40 rupees, four times that money. So there are lots of schemes Government of India is launching. But that is where, it's a completely different topic, that the academia-industry collaboration in India has still not developed much. And that is because industry thinks that we are all doing blue sky research which is not applicable to them. And academia thinks that their problems are all such low level problems that we don't want to waste our time kind of thing. So there is a lot of trust problem between industry and academia. There are programs now, in fact, also very strongly advocating that, because that will also give us the right problems. When Maruti comes and says that we need to develop this vehicle in 10 years timeline, with these technologies, that is a good research problem if Maruti can fund it. And that is what that needs to happen. But if Maruti continuously gets those technologies from Suzuki, and if Suzuki does that research in Japan, there's nothing that will happen here. They will only come here, assemble it and sell it. Therefore, nothing happens to the Indian academy. So unfortunately, that is the current situation. Many of these big industries are basically importing technologies and assembling them and selling them here. And there are not too many companies which are developing technologies indigenously and reaching out to market. And when that R&D culture in the industry grows, then they will require more PhDs. They will have no choice but to interact with the academia, and many things will happen. So it's a matter of time. Eventually it will happen. But right now, it is still not on a scale which we would have liked to see.
Yes, sir.
Maybe
let us
have others, or we'll come back to it.
Sir, nowadays, it is general scenario that if our parents come to medical field, then they will pressurize or force us to go in medical field. Or
I thought it's opposite. Yes. I know many doctors who wanted children to become engineers.
Yes, sir. I just want to know that which way we can assure that we are on the right way according to our choice, and there is no any misharm in going our way. So how can we assure them that we are on the right way?
There is nothing like a right way or wrong way. There are all ways you need to traverse and find out.
They think that we should go in clear of their choice, or that we are not on the right path. So is there any way by which we can assure them?
I think whatever you do, you need to do well. I think that's what everybody will tell you. I don't think there is anything like a right path or wrong path. I mean, so long as you are finding it interesting, and so long as you are, when you like some work, you work for hours without looking at your watch. And if you don't like it, every minute starts to look boring kind of thing.
So you need to find, you know, what interests you. And once you find it, every area is interesting. You know, so the, even in humanities area, very interesting. If you can find that right problem where you feel passionate about, nothing wrong in doing humanities. What is wrong in that? In fact, I keep telling our humanities faculty that, you know, humanities departments have a major role to play in IITs, because they are the people who now give us the problems. Now a humanities faculty member coming and saying that, you know, there were so many former suicides in the last 5 years, and many of them, they analyze the whole problem and say that these are problems are because of this reason. And if they can come and tell us that and analyze that whole problem for engineers, then we will know where the problem is. We can start to look at technologies to address that. So they are our connect to the world, the society. And that is what, you know, is a very important aspect of every humanities department. So that, therefore, I don't think any area is inferior, and chemistry is as important as electrical engineering. There is no area which is less compared to the other. And it's just a matter of, you know, being able to work on a problem together in a group, and then where you contribute from your expertise to the complete solution to the problem is what is important. I don't think that any area is
okay. Sir, recently I've heard that inter-IIT is basically supposed to be conducted in IIT Delhi for 2018 now. So recently we were told that because of certain space crunch and because of accommodation issues were there for the teams that might be arriving, we might not be able to have it in Delhi. So so what exactly can we do to change this?
It has already reached you, and I don't think any decision was taken. There is a sports complex which we are starting now. There will be a very ultra modern sports complex, and we also wanted girls' accommodation problem to be solved. When inter-IIT meeting, so many people come and descend on the campus, and we are worried, you know, given our hostel situation, you know, what will happen kind of a thing. So somebody proposed that can we postpone it by a year. Are you graduating next year? You were some problem.
They already got delayed by of the flats in Madras. So like,
we want it to happen despite anything.
We would definitely have. I mean, I would definitely prefer having a better accommodation solution for in fact everyone on campus, because we saw a space crunch in the girls' hostel for the freshers that came. So even in that case.
That will happen. So the but this inter-IIT thing still we're discussing. We want to do it in a proper way. So not with so many constraints. But I'm also told that IIT Delhi became a general champion whenever IIT Delhi hosted the inter-IIT sports. Otherwise we are always second or third kind of thing. I don't know why, but there are I did not know the level of politics in inter-IIT sports. You know, when I started to hear about those other stories as to how other institutes behave in those inter-IIT, I never thought that what is required is to build a business model, the cooperative society of Amul and all of that. You know, somebody came up with a business model to do all of that. That is what the MBA schools need to be doing. Unfortunately, you know, the MBA program, they're all looking at US for long. They are still studying Pepsi and Coca-Cola as the business models. But, you know, I'm actually telling our MBA programs that can you look at, you know, the agricultural sector in India, and then what kind of business models you need to come up with so that our farmers can buy these technologies. So that is business model innovation. There is nothing wrong in people doing MBAs, in my opinion, so long as it is again looking at the right problems with that perspective. What is wrong in IES? Nothing wrong in IES. I mean, if you ask me, they are all opportunities for you to contribute to the society. Right? So personally, I don't, because engineering, like I said, is all about thinking process. Now, as after 4 years of learning, now to me, when I, you know, after so many years of training as an engineer, when I look at a problem, I look at it in a certain way. That my problem, you know, the way I approach a problem is very different from medical doctor would approach a problem. Now, as engineers, it is all about problem solving skills. It is all about optimization. when an engineer becomes an IAS officer, you know, if you apply the same problem solving skills, you will actually do much better than an economist doing the, you know, doing the same kind of a work. So therefore, engineering is all about solving a problem using a certain methodology. That is what an engineering is supposed to teach. And with that methodology, you approach any problem. You do MBA, you do going to IAS, you will still do it. What is important is that problem solving skills.